Police are still on the hunt for a suspect wanted in connection with a violent and unexpected attack in Surrey over the weekend that's left a pair of restaurant workers recovering in hospital. It happened just after noon yesterday at the business on King George Boulevard near 72nd Avenue. The two cooks were injured when a man barged in through the back of the restaurant. They tried to calm the intruder, but he picked up a knife and stabbed them. The cooks are expected to make full recoveries. The suspect is described as white, in his 40s, with a heavy build, wearing glasses and a black jacket with red lettering. Meanwhile, in Richmond, RCMP are still looking for suspects in a violent home invasion. Four men burst into the house on Jack Bell Drive at around 3 o'clock on Saturday morning. A man inside confronted them and received non-life-threatening injuries. His wife was not injured. The couple could not provide investigators with a description of the intruders or their vehicle. The man accused in the stabbing death of a passenger on a Kelowna bus last week is scheduled to appear in court this morning. The man has been charged with the second-degree murder of a 55-year-old man. Police are calling this a random attack. More than a dozen other passengers watched in horror as the man bled to death on the bus. Court records identify the suspect as 24-year-old Tyler Jack Newton. Canadian warplanes have carried out their first combat airstrikes against Islamic State extremists in Iraq. Defense Minister Rob Nicholson says two CF-18 jets attacked targets with laser-guided bombs near Fallujah, west of Baghdad. All of the planes have returned safely to their base in Kuwait. Damage to the targets is being assessed, but there's no word yet on what kind of targets were hit. Nicholson says there will be no further information until tomorrow. Well, after the events of Ottawa and Quebec, the service of Canadian soldiers is bound to carry significant meaning this season. And this year's Poppy campaign for the Royal Canadian Legion is now underway. Greg Harper is live in Vancouver with more on that this morning. Greg.
Good morning, Kyle. Yes, just outside Victory Square in Vancouver this morning, ahead of Remembrance Day, the Royal Canadian Legion has begun its annual Poppy campaign. The money raised goes to help veterans and their dependents. It also goes towards Legion halls and all sorts of other charities as well. During the Poppy campaign, about 18 million poppies are distributed across Canada and overseas annually. And because of the events in Ottawa and Quebec, organizers expect that number to go up this year.
We're expecting a very high demand for poppies this year. We've ordered 2.3 million in BC and Yukon Command, and our hope is that every single person will be wearing a poppy and showing their support for our military personnel.
So look for veterans, cadets, and volunteers who will be selling poppies at public places throughout Metro Vancouver and the province as well. Maybe get yourself a couple of poppies this year. Kyle?
Greg Harper, live in downtown Vancouver. Greg, thanks for that. With less than 2 weeks to go until civic elections across the province, Surrey's campaign could be facing a legal situation. The One Surrey Party is mulling its next course of action after a balloting fiasco. Two of its council candidates, Michael Bowes and Maz Artang, were listed as unaffiliated. The mistake was quickly spotted, but not before ballots were cast during advance polling.
At this point, I think this is a very unfortunate error. It calls questions the integrity of the electoral process here in Canada. We are viewed around the world. Experts go from Canada to help countries like Ukraine and Peru. So I think that definitely this is an issue. Don't want to say it's anything more than an unfortunate error.
Rival party Surrey First has wondered whether the paperwork of the affected candidates was completed properly. That's something One Surrey has dismissed. The next advance voting in the city happens tomorrow. Elections officials have assured One Surrey proper ballots will be used. Meantime, one civic election expert says the lead-up to the November 15th election has been rather dull in some ridings. Does it stem from voter apathy? Are candidates not doing a particularly good job of engaging voters? Or does it simply mean people are relatively satisfied with the way their municipal government is conducting its business?
Would we prefer to be Toronto? They have a very exciting municipal politics, and it's been really a bit of a circus. Or you look at Montreal, where there have been very serious problems with corruption. Really, we're fairly well served in Vancouver in the sense that there's not a lot of corruption. We're fairly well governed. And so if it's boring, that may not be such a bad thing.
Well, today marks a major milestone at Ground Zero in New York City. The resurrected World Trade Center is opening for business today, 13 years after the 9/11 terror attacks. Publishing giant Condé Nast will start moving into One World Trade Center today. The 104-story, $3.9 billion skyscraper dominates the Manhattan skyline and is now America's tallest building. The Port Authority of New York and New Jersey owns the building and the World Trade Center site. Operators of a Surrey mill are once again picking up the pieces after another big fire. The cleanup and investigation following Saturday's Mackenzie Mill fire continues this morning, although the blaze is not considered to be suspicious. The mill on 130th Street went up in flames at around 1 a.m. on Saturday. The flames were mostly contained to one main building, which was left virtually destroyed. That portion was still under renovation following another blaze in 2011, which left more than 100 people out of work. The mill has not been fully operational since then. Controversial taxi alternative Uber is reportedly planning an expansion into Vancouver, despite the city telling the U.S. company it cannot legally operate here. Uber allows anyone with a car and a driver's license to pick up passengers. The company recently posted job ads and is also accepting applications for prospective drivers. Vancouver recently voted not to hand out new taxi licenses, but the company argues it is not a taxi service and therefore should not be governed by those regulations. The company is currently in Toronto, Montreal, Halifax, and Ottawa, where it's operating without proper licensing. Traveling with luggage just got a little more expensive for some Air Canada passengers. Travelers flying economy within Canada or to the Caribbean or Mexico will now have to pay extra. Your first two checked bags are now costing $25 each. As you can imagine, many travelers are not thrilled with the extra fees. Air Canada figures the change will affect one in five customers. It comes just days after a similar change in luggage policies by WestJet. Two RCMP officers involved in Robert Jakansky's death at Vancouver International Airport are scheduled to be in court this morning on perjury charges. All four officers involved when Jakansky was stunned with a taser and died in October of 2007 were later charged with perjury for their testimony at a public inquiry. Constable Kwesi Millington, who fired the taser, is scheduled to begin his trial today, while former Corporal Monty Robinson's trial started last week and has yet to finish. The Crown alleges the officers lied to police about what happened and then lied again at the inquiry. Toronto police are appealing for public assistance in their criminal investigation of former CBC radio host Gian Gomeshi now that three women have come forward to complain. Investigators want anyone to come forward with evidence such as video, photographs, or social media chats related to this case. Police got involved after a CBC announcement on Friday. The corporation says it had graphic evidence Gomeshi caused physical injury to a person, and that's what prompted his firing. A 13-year-old cadet is doing his part for this year's Remembrance Day. Jackson Reed has been a steady presence at Veterans Park in Port Coquitlam. He's been selling poppies and standing guard at the Cenotaph in honor of Corporal Nathan Cirillo and Warrant Officer Patrice Vincent.
I don't feel that happy. I feel sad when I'm standing here for the fallen soldiers, but I do feel proud because I am standing here and I'm standing for a reason.
Jackson initially stood guard at the Cenotaph in his cadet uniform, but he'll now do so in street clothes at the wishes of military leaders. He had to step away yesterday, though, while it was pressure washed. Two world records have been broken by a man who took on two high-wire walks between Chicago skyscrapers last night without a net or a harness and blindfolded.
You guys watching think I'm crazy, but this is what I was made for.
Amazing here. This is daredevil Nick Walenda. He walked more than two city blocks uphill on a steel wire at a 19-degree angle from the West Tower of the Marina City Towers to the Leo Burnett Building, more than 50 stories high above the Chicago River. His second skyscraper walk was 29 meters long and 166 meters high. The 35-year-old comes from a family called the Flying Walendas.
You probably saw me shaking like a leaf. That wire was shaking underneath me, and, you know, I just wanted to make it to the other side. I wasn't going to think twice. I was getting on the wire. I'm going.